Now, we are going to talk about the second method in this idea of neighborhood sampling and trying to limit batch size issues in graph neural networks. And the way we are going to do this is to start with the following observation, right? That the size of computational graphs can still become very big or increases exponentially with the number of GNN layers. And what we can also observe and notice is that computation in these computational graphs can be very much redundant because of shared neighbors, right? If you think, for example, two nodes A and B, and you think about their computation graphs, then they have, because they share, they have a lot of friends in common, these computation graphs are heavily redundant, right? Like both to compute A and compute B, the subgraphs, the parts of the computation graphs below nodes C and D are identical. So this will be the duplicated computation. And there are two approaches to do this. One is to realize that this computation is duplicated and computed only once. There is a very nice paper about this at last year KDD called HAGs, hierarchical aggregation graphs that basically prevent multiple computations, so redundant computations. And the second case will be about Cluster-GCN, which is what I'm going to talk about today. And the way we are motivating Cluster-GCN is to remember what is a full batch graph neural network, right? A full batch graph neural network is that all the embeddings for all the nodes are embedded together in a single pass. So basically, embeddings of all the nodes are computed for layer 1, embeddings for all the nodes are then computed for layer 2, and so on, right? The point is, you need to have the embeddings of all the nodes at layer L minus 1 to be able to compute the embeddings for all the other nodes, for all the nodes at layer L. So it means that in each layer, 2 times number of edges messages need to be exchanged because every node needs to connect, collect the messages from its neighbors. So there are 2 messages along each undirected edge, you know, for both endpoints. And what is the observation? The observation is that the amount of computation we need to do in a single layer of a, let's say, a full batch implementation is linear in the size of the graph. It's linear in the number of edges, so it means it is very fast. But the problem is that graphs are too big, so we cannot do this kind of at once in the GPU. So the insight from full batch GNN is that layer-wise node embedding updates allow us to reuse embeddings from the previous layer. And this significantly reduces the computational redundancy of neighborhood sampling, right? This means that this layer-wise update to generate embeddings from one layer to the next is very cheap, right? All I need to do is previous layer embeddings, I need to aggregate them, combine them with the previous layer embedding of a given node, and I have a new embedding. So what this means is that this can be done very fast. It's only linear time operation in the size of the graph because this aggregation basically takes time linear because it's linear number of edges over which we aggregate. So this means that the computations are very fast, but of course the problem is that layer-wise update is not feasible for the entire graph at once because of the GPU memory. So now what the idea is in the Cluster-GCN is that can we sample the entire graph into small subparts and then perform full batch implementation on those subgraphs, right? So the idea is the following. I'll take the large graph. I'm going to sample a subgraph of it. I don't know, maybe I'll just say I'll sample this subgraph. And then I'm going, and this subgraph I'm able to fit in on a GPU. So now I can apply a full batch implementation in the GPU on that sampled subgraph. Right, so that's essentially the idea. So the difference between neighborhood sampling is that there we compute the computation graph for each individual node. Here we are going to sample an entire subgraph of the original graph and then pretend that this is the graph of interest and just perform GNN on that subgraph. Right, so then the question is, how should I sample these subgraphs? What are good subgraphs for training GNNs? And here's the reasoning. The important point to remember is that GNN performs embedding by passing messages via the edges of the network, right? Every node computes its embedding by collecting information from the neighbors. Right, so the idea is now if I want to have a good subgraph, the good subgraph has to retain as many of the edges of the original graph as possible so that my computations mimic the computations on the big graph as well as possible. So our subgraphs should retain edge connectivity structure of the original graph as much as possible, which means that the GNN over the subgraph generates embeddings that are close to the GNN over the original graph. So to give you an idea, if I have an original graph, and let's say I sample a subgraph on four nodes like I show here on the left, or I sample another subgraph on four nodes like I show on the right, then it's clear that the left subgraph is kind of much better for training, because if I now say, let's compute the embedding of this corner node up here, here all the three neighbors of it are in the subgraph, so I'll be able to get a quite good estimate of the embedding of this corner node up here. So, right, it's all of its neighbors are part of my subgraph. While if I take this other subgraph here, denoted by green nodes, and I want to predict or generate an embedding for this green node as well, then all I'm able to do is aggregate message from one of its neighbors, because only one of its neighbors is part of my subgraph, right? So the right subgraph drops many, many edges, and leading to isolated nodes, which means my computation graphs over this subgraph won't be representative of the computation graphs in the original graph. So left choice is far better than the right choice. And this now brings us back to the network community structure, because real-world graphs exhibit community structure, they exhibit clustering structure. So a large graph can be decomposed into many small communities. And the key insight would be that we can sample these subgraphs based on the community structure so that each subgraph retains most of the edges and only few edges are dropped. So a cluster GCN, the way it works, it has a two-step process. In the pre-processing step, we take the original graph and split it, cut it into many small subgraphs. And then mini batch training means that we sample one node group, one subgraph, and perform the full batch message passing over that entire subgraph, compute the node embeddings of all the nodes in the subgraph, evaluate the loss, compute the gradient, and update the parameters, right? So the idea is input graph, split into many subgraphs. We take one subgraph, fit it into the GPU memory, do the full computation on the subgraph, compute the loss, update model parameters. Load in another subgraph, do the full batch layer embeddings of all the nodes in the subgraph, compute the loss, update the gradient, load the next subgraph. So that's how vanilla cluster GCN would work. So to give you more details, the idea is that given a large graph, we're going to partition it into, let's say, capital C groups. We can use some scalable community detection method like Louvain, like Metis method, or we can use even Big Clam is fine. And then basically this set of node groups V, we are going to take an induced subgraph on this subset of nodes. And basically this induced subgraphs will include all the edges between the members of the group. And of course, these edges that go across the subgraphs, those will be dropped. So between group edges are going to be dropped in these graphs G1 to GC, which are these subgraphs we sample. So now for each mini batch, we are going to sample one such node group, one such subgraph, create an induced subgraph over that set of nodes. And this is now our graph that we are going to use as a computation in the GPU. So the point is that this induced subgraph has to fit into the GPU memory. So now we do layer-wise node update, basically the same thing as what we do in the full batch GNN, to compute now the embeddings of all the nodes in the subgraph. We compute the loss, and then do the compute the gradient with respect to the loss, and then do the gradient update. So the point here is that when we were doing graph-sage neighborhood sampling, our nodes, we were able to kind of sample them all across the graphs. But in this case, we are going to sample a subgraph of the original graph and now only compute on those nodes we have sampled. And that's the big difference between the neighborhood sampling that can be kind of, those neighborhoods can be distributed across the entire network, while here we are going to create those neighborhoods basically just being limited to the subgraph we sample and we feed that subgraph into the GPU memory. So what are some issues and how do we fix them? The issue with Cluster-GCN is that these induced subgraphs remove between the group links, between subgraph links. And as a result, messages from other groups will be lost during message passing, which can hurt GNN performance. Right? So for example, if I sample this red graph here and I just zoom in into the into it, what I see is that, for example, whenever this particular node aggregates information, it will never aggregate information from these two edges because these two, the node endpoints are part of the different subgraph. So all the message aggregation will happen only between these four nodes and the five edges between them. So there will be, in some sense, lost messages. So the issue would be because the graph community detection puts similar nodes together into the same group, sample node groups tend to cover only a small concentrated portion of the entire graph, right? So we are going to learn only on a small concentrated portions of the graph, while neighborhood sampling allows us to kind of learn on small but very diverse set of neighborhoods. And this means that because this sampled node, sample subgraph, will be a concentrated part of the entire graph, it won't be kind of diverse or representative to represent the entire training graphs. So what this means is that when we compute the gradient and the loss, this is going to fluctuate a lot from one node group to another because of the social communities. If you think of it that way, each subgroup will be very concentrated in one given aspect and the model will have hard time to learn, right? You will, you have a cluster of computer scientists, so you will learn how to make, you will compute the gradient with respect to computer scientists. Then you have a cluster of, let's say, music students, and now your gradient that you have just, your models that were just computed over the computer scientist in your social network are now going to be computed over music people, which are very, very different. And then, you have mathematicians who are different, community of mathematicians who are different from the two. So the gradients are going to fluctuate quite a lot, and training is quite unstable, which in practice leads to slow convergence of gradient descent, of stochastic gradient descent. So a way to improve this is what is called advanced cluster GCN. And the idea is that here we want to aggregate multiple node groups per mini batch, right? So the idea is to make the graphs we sample even smaller, but then we are going to sample multiple of these subgraphs into the mini batch, and we are going to create an induced subgraph on the aggregated node group that is now composed of many small node groups. And the rest will be the same as in the cluster GCN, which is take now the induced subgraph, put it into the GPU memory, and create the update. But the point is now that these subgroups can be more diverse, so the induced subgraph will be more diverse, so your gradients will be more stable and more representative. So here is the picture. The picture is that now my node groups are smaller than what I had before, but I can sample more of them. So I sample here two node groups, and now the sampled subgraph is the induced subgraph on the nodes belonging to the two groups. So I will also include this blue edge that kind of connects the two groups. So it means that this makes the sample nodes more representative, more diverse. They are more representative of the entire node population, which will lead to better gradient estimate, less variance in gradients, and faster training and convergence. So just to say more, right? This is again a two-step approach. I take the nodes, I separate them into very small subgroups, much smaller than the original version. But when I'm doing mini batch training, I will sample multiple groups of nodes, and then I will aggregate these groups of nodes into one supergroup. And then I'm going to create an induced subgraph on the entire supergroup. And then I'm going to include edges between all the members of the supergroup, which means it will be edges between the small subgroups as well as the edges between the small subgroups. And then I will perform a cluster GCN the same way as we did before. So now, if I compare the cluster GCN approach with the neighborhood sampling approach, here is how the two compare. The neighborhood sampling says sample h nodes per layer, and let's do this for m nodes in the network. So the total size of the mini batch will be m times h raised to the power of k. M is the number of computation graph, h is the fan out of computation graphs, and k is the number of layers of the GNN. So for m nodes in the computation graph, our cost in terms of memory as well as computation will be m times h to the k. In the cluster GCN, we are performing message passing over a subgraph induced by m nodes. And the subgraph over m nodes is going to include m times average degree number of edges, right? Each node in the subgraph has an average degree of d average. So in total, we will have m times average degree number of edges in the graph. And because we are doing k-hop message passing, the computational cost of this approach will be k times m, size of the subgraph, times the average degree. So if you compare the two, in summary, the cost to generate embeddings from m nodes in a k-layer GNN is m to the m times h to the k. In cluster GCN, it is k times m times average degree. And if you assume, let's say, h to be half of the average degree, then it would mean that cluster GCN is much more computationally efficient than neighborhood sampling. So it is linear instead of exponential with respect to the depth. So what we do in practice, it depends a bit on the data set. Usually we set h to be bigger than the half average degree, perhaps, you know, 2 times, 3 times average degree. And because number of layers k is not that deep, the neighborhood sampling approach tends to be kind of more used in practice. So to summarize, cluster GCN first partitions the entire set of nodes in the graph into a small node groups. In each mini batch, multiple node groups are sampled, and their nodes are kind of aggregated together. Then an induced subgraph on this nodes from the union of the groups that we have sampled is created, and then the GNN performs layer-wise node embeddings update over this induced subgraph. Generally, cluster GCN is more computationally efficient than neighborhood sampling, especially when the number of layers is large. But cluster GCN leads to systematically biased gradients because of missing cross-community edges, and also because if number of layers is deep, then in the original graph, if you do neighborhood sampling, you can really go deep. But in the cluster GCN, you are only going to go to the edge of the original of the sampled graph, and then you'll kind of bounce back. And even though you have a lot of depth, this depth will be kind of oscillating over the subgraph and won't even really explore the real depth of the underlying original graph. So overall, I would say neighborhood sampling is used more because of additional flexibility.